next week at Rutgers University.
Well, let's take a look at the individual lineups. First of all, starting with the Mount Washington Wolfpack. This team has the big marquee name.
They sure do. And let's start with the Gait brothers. They give Mount Washington that offensive punch that they're famous for. They can put the ball in the goal from any time at anywhere. Extremely dangerous. I think they've revolutionized the sport of lacrosse in the past decade. Also, defensively, Mount Washington is not weak. In fact, they have who I consider to be one of the top players in the world at that position, and that's Dave Pietramala. So offensively and defensively, the Wolfpack very, very tough.
Of course, Dave Pietramala voted the best defenseman in the world at the last World Games held in Australia. Now, Don, when you look at the Brine team, not as many marquee players, but obviously a very strong squad.
Yeah, they have to be a good squad to get to this game. They don't have the marquee players that Mount Washington has, but they're playing very well as a team. Offensively, their punch comes from Dennis Goldstein, formerly from North Carolina, an excellent attackman, and from the midfield, Tim Soudan, who starred at UMass during his college days. Defensively, they'll rely on Steve Byrne, a standout at the University of Virginia, to try to stop the potent Mount Washington offense.
And the way the club defense goes, Steve Byrne is an impact player, but you may not see him even start. He may start long sticks defense in the midfield. We'll see where he will play his impact position from the defensive end. Don and I will be back to talk about this game as we get started. We'll take a look at the starting lineups in just a moment when we come back to the USCLA Club Championship. Welcome back to home field. The Brine team is going to face off against the Mount Washington Wolfpack. Let's take a quick look at the starting lineups as we get ready to start this game. I'm Lee Felsmo, joined by Don Zimmerman. And Don, for the attack, the Mount Washington squad, it'll be Marl, Delegati, and Blatchley.
Look for Marl to be the dodger on this unit, and Blatchley the feeder. Delegati will try to finish.
In the midfield area, this team is loaded. Gait, and Rob Sheck.
Both Gates, powerful left-handers. Sheck can do it all also.
On the defensive end of the field, no unit could be better than this. Pietramala, Matt Wilson, Ronnie Klausner.
Pietramala could be the best in the game. Wilson and Klausner solid also.
And the goal for this team, we'll take a look a little bit later, but let's first go to the attack on the Brine squad. It'll be Goldstein, the feeder, Hiller, and Marino.
Hiller, one of the top finishers in the game.
In the midfield now for the Brine squad, Soudan, the great scorer we talked about, Blanchard and Donovan.
Soudan plays big for his size.
Moving down to the defensive end of the field for Brine, this is where they can be very tough. Breshy, Kane, and McCormick.
Three good defenders are the work cut out for them tonight.
Now let's get back to those goalies we talked about. Every game of this size, the goalies are very important. Linthicum in the goal for Mount Washington. McCabe for Brine. They'll be tested. Don tells me this will be a shooter's field. We'll explain when we come back and start the USCLA Club Championship. Lee Felsmo and Don Zimmerman all set for quarter number one of this great USCLA championship. And again, as we look in the goal, very, very important in a game like this. And each goal will be tested. It's the shooter's field, Don. Explain that.
Well, it's been a late rain out here, Leith, and that AstroTurf makes it a slick shot. The ball will accelerate on the shots, and both goalies are going to have their work cut out for them.
Tim Soudan will start facing off for Brine. He loses it to the face-off specialist. Oh, I'm sorry. I mean, he picks it up. Teammate Dave Donovan comes in. He's facing off against number eight from Mount Washington, Greg Gunning. Gunning played his Hopkins lacrosse right here on this field. And he is a face-off specialist. Right now playing defense, Gunning is, against the midfielder crashing in, Charlie Blanchard. A lot of New England talent throughout the lineup of the Brine team. Brine in red, Mount Washington Wolfpack in the white jerseys. And now they have it up top with Donovan initiating play. Going against the long stick check, that'll be Ronnie Klausner with a big long check, gets the ball. Transition is what Mount Washington loves.
That's right. There's a good example. Pietramala takes the ball away, gets it up the field to Volker. Brine did a nice job of getting back in the hole and picking away their transition offense.
Now we got Donnie Zimmerman again giving us his color commentary. He coached a lot of these players, including Brine Volker, who we just saw. That was Gary Gait taking a shot, number 22, maybe the best offensive player on the field of lacrosse today and maybe of all time. He'll be number 22 in the white jersey. Ball goes back to his teammate, Mike Marl, who played here at Hopkins, and he will initiate play back there. Mike looks very comfortable back there on this field. There's a shot and a goal. Gary Gait, the left hand. We talked about how potent that left-handed shot is. That one didn't bounce. Didn't get the benefit of the west turf. Just high velocity.
Right. You can't give Gary Gait that much room to shoot the ball. You have to be alert to the whistle. You have to be ready to play before the whistle starts. Brine that time wasn't. Gary Gait was able to get the shot off, and with that much room and time, Gary Gates going to score every time.
Looks like Tim Soudan playing a little bit of defense on Gary Gait. Now they go back off for the face-off number two. It'll be number eight for Mount Washington. As I mentioned, Greg Gunning will face off as a specialist. He loses again, this time to number 13 for the Brine squad, who takes a hard shot right in the face of goalie Linthicum. Nice save for him. Face-off now 2-0 for the Brine team. Clouser now will set up his clear.
That time, Brine had an excellent opportunity coming down on a 4-on-3. But the shooter shot the ball low to low. You have to take advantage of this turf, shoot the high bouncer against these goalkeepers.
In club ball, if you've watched some of the college collegiate play this year on some of the regional networks, it's a little bit different in the club level. It's more like international play. They play 20-minute running time, a lot of long sticks. No requirement for long sticks. You might see as many as six long sticks on the field at one time.
That's a good ride by the Brine team, getting a second chance. As a coach, you try to limit the offense's second chances. And Brian did a nice job riding the ball there.
And they got it back immediately. The defense packed it in. And, Donnie, you can see the emphasis on good team defense by the Mount Washington Wolfpack.
We got a mismatch here. We have Goldstein being played by a midfielder, and that's going to cause Mount Washington to slide, which they did.
Now, that midfielder had a shorter stick than the defensive specialist, giving Goldstein a little bit of an edge to get a shot off. But good team defense turned away any kind of shot. Now unsettled and missed out in front one more time.
Brian's doing a nice job of controlling the tempo here, and again, that's what they have to do against this Mount Washington team. Your best defense is a ball control offense, and that's something that Brian seems to be working on, although they didn't back up that shot, and that's going to cost them possession.
Dennis Goldstein takes a shot. John, he presents a lot of problems. He can feed so beautifully, and ball control is the name of his game. But he came from behind, took the feed that time, and has an excellent shot.
Right, but Brian didn't have anybody to back up the shot. And as an offensive squad, you have to back up those shots because in lacrosse, as you know, you do get the ball back on a shot.
The shot, and you're closest to the ball. It goes out of bounds. You retain possession. Now the Mount Washington Wolfpack sets up their offense. It didn't take them long to get goal number one. They lead 1-0 with 16:20 left in quarter number one. It's running time. Lee Felsmo and Don Zimmerman bringing you this action.
This is the second midfield for Mount Washington now, Lee. That's Brendan Kelly, Butch Marino, and Todd Curry. Also an excellent offensive midfield group. They like to run this little play they just ran. Very good off-ball team.
And Brendan Kelly played his collegiate lacrosse right here. Looking for the cutting player out front was Todd Curry of Syracuse fame, an All-American midfielder there. Pietramala comes across.
Great play by Pietramala.
Flag down, Don.
Well, it was a great play by Pietramala, but also give Brendan Kelly credit. He got back on side, which allowed Pietramala to then go over with the ball, and it looks like Brian may have a penalty for being offside.
Morrow's wrapped up defensively by the Brine squad. And now that extra man unit will come on. Gary Gait runs back out.
Brushy tried to go over Morrow's head that time, and Morrow's very good at baiting that and protecting the stick. The way to play Morrow is just good, solid position, try to take away his right hand.
So Morrow cuts through. Butch Marino on the shooter right-hand side. This is Rob Sheck. That's Marino right there. He's got the cannon, but it was knocked away at the last moment by the defensive Brine. Steve Byrne got in the way. He wears number 20 in the red jersey.
Good, smart play by Todd Francis that time. Poke check on the arm allowed Brine to keep possession of the ball.
And this is Chris McCabe now setting up the clear. In collegiate ball, you have time zones. Does it differ here in the club play?
Yeah, there's no zone, so to speak, in club lacrosse. You can pretty much play a full field game. There is no offensive and defensive clearing zone, so to speak.
So Gary Gait waved at him on the offensive end of the field. They have got long sticks. Mount Washington White does down there. Gary Gait stayed in the offensive zone. They get the ball back. And now Klausner gets it all the way over to Pietramala. Lost it a little bit. Might have been a problem. It'll be Pietramala now against Goldstein, number five. As they work it out to Scott Hiller. Scott Hiller's got a man open inside. Good feed into David Donovan from Duke. Donovan just pulled it tight to the inside.
One thing you'll notice about the club game is that it's a real quick whistle, Lee. and you have to be heads up and alert. You can't relax on any kind of whistle to stop play because play is going to start right away. That time, Brine had a chance. Mount Washington wasn't alert to the second whistle, and they had an opportunity to score. Again, they didn't back up the shot, which cost them the turnover of the ball.
Mount Washington controls the ball. They lead the game 1-0. They scored in the first minute and a half of the game. Gary Gait got that goal, and now they control. Joe Bresci playing defense against the offensive talents of Mike Morrow.
Bresci did a nice job that time. He kept the stick in the feeder's gloves, and that's what you want to do. When the player's behind the goal and he's looking to feed, you shouldn't have your stick up in the air trying to knock the ball down. You should try to get in his gloves and throw the poke when he does attempt to feed the ball.
So Curry, number 16, gives it back to his midfield teammate, Butch Marino, out of Delaware. Marino's got that cannon right-handed shot, and that's what he likes to take. Morrow now working the ball around back to John Blatchley from Towson State, a new addition to the Mount Washington team. Very good feeder, Blatchley is. That left-handed shot, not a lot of juice on it by Martino. And Brian putting on the jet. Tim Soudan looking to clear all the way across. They tried to get it back. Roddy Marino did, but Soudan didn't get it. This dude's got the best stamina because this is two straight 100-yard sprints. That's a goal by Mike Morrow. He came up, took the feed. I think it looked like Brian was a little bit tired. They ran a fast break, came back down the other way. Goal number two for Mount Washington. Mike Morrow and Gary Gait get him off to a good start.
Well, that's just a heads-up play by Bob Martino. He's bringing the ball down the field. Morrow snuck from behind the goal. Perfect feed. Goalie had to play Morrow. Open goal for a score.
Mount Washington take the 2-0 lead in the first quarter. And we'll be back with more from the USCLA Championship in just a moment. Still 2-0, the Mount Washington Wolfpack ahead of Brine. This is for the USCLA Championship. Randy Fraser will be out there facing off in red for Brine. And Gunning will be out there as the specialist for the Mount Washington Wolfpack.
Greg Gunning, a very good face-off man.
0-3 though, Don.
0-3, but you know it's a long game. He was very instrumental in the 1987 championship game when Hopkins defeated Cornell at Rutgers, won the first eight draws.
Another one of the many players who put in most of his hours on this same AstroTurf field. Now Brian sets up their offense with Tom Carmian out in front. Got All-American status at Mass, gets it in close, and that's Scott Hiller, who picked up a loose ball right in front of the goal and gets the first one for Brine. Opportunistic, but that could really get them off the hook.
Well, that was a little bit of a lucky play, but you got to give Hiller credit. He was heads up. He got the loose ball inside. Mount Washington threw the sticks, and they have to take body on that play. No way Hiller should have scored that goal standing up.
You see Pietramala number 43, Klausner 44, both of them playing the ball. Nobody clearing out the body. I think, Don, you go way back, the coaching philosophy there is to clear out that lane in front of the goalie and don't let anybody get that cheap goal.
Right. Goalkeeper's responsible for the loose ball around the crease. The defenders, their job is to take the man.
First faceoff won by the Mount Washington squad. Klausner playing on the wing, comes in with a long stick. It's still in play. Now there's trouble. Klausner will come back and corral it. As Paul Gate comes in, they'll try to balance these lines.
Actually, Mount Washington went with Klausner facing off that time, Leaf. He will come in and face off when they feel Gunning's not being effective, and Coach Lickfus went to him early.
And he used that long stick to face off. Shows you how deft and agile he is, even though he's using that six-foot-long pole. Brian sending up the offense, number 5 to Dennis Goldstein, great control feeder. All the way across the far side, Hiller takes the shot that bounces over. And Don, you talked about a shooter's field. I guess that takes full advantage of that. You want to come maybe a little more underhand and make the ball squirt.
Well, you want to shoot the high bouncer. I think is the best shot on a wet turf field. The thing that Brian has to do is they have to shoot the ball. They can't try to get too cute with the ball and work for the 3 to 5 yard shot. On a field like this and against this Mount Washington defense, they have to be willing to take the 10 to 15 yard shot.
Wingate Pritchett just made a big save. He backed up his goalie, stood behind Linficum, and Wingate Pritchett made that save to turn the ball back to his offense. Paul Gait in for the left. A check at the last moment by Bresci takes it out of his stick, and it's still loose. Playing the red line.
That time it looked like the Brine player was out of bounds playing the ball, and that should have been a whistle and ball rewarded to Mount Washington.
9:40 left, running time, first quarter. They play 20-minute running times in the club ranks. Lee Felsmo, Don Zimmerman, the USCLA Club Championship. Brine from the north, Mount Washington Wolfpack from the south. There's a shot that finds his way in the goal. That'll be goal number two, yes. He had good screens in front of him. I don't think Lincecum got a good shot at that. He really didn't know where it was coming from. And the ball got behind him to tie the game at two.
No, that shot was definitely screened by the people that were inside. And this is something, again, that you have to do against Mount Washington. You have to be willing to shoot the ball from the outside. That time Lincecum was screened, and it's a goal.
And Hiller gets two in a row. Watch this nice move around. Wingate Pritchard, who just made a save, he fakes the right-hand shot, wheels around for the left, and Hiller now has strapped Brine on his back and gotten two straight goals to knock this one up. Mount Washington started off with Gary Gates scoring and then Mike Morrow on an opportunistic goal. 2-2 with nine left in the first quarter.
Again, Mount Washington faceoff Klausner gives them three long sticks on the faceoff unit.
Jeff Klausner, number seven. Let's talk about the three long sticks, and number five, Brine Volker. Brine Volker, one of the best long sticks or best defensive period to ever play for John Tocken.
Excellent player in college. Brian's tough, not afraid to scrap it up, and been very effective for the Wolfpack this year.
Mount Washington now, after that little scrum for possession, will set up their offense. They're in white. Now they move around. Morrow looks out front. This will be Sheck out to Paul Gates. Takes a hard wrap for defense and gets off a check shot. Tim Soudan got a little piece of it. Gary Gates had two shots, Jimmy, but he hasn't really gotten a clean one yet.
No, the thing that you have to do against the Gates is you have to try to force him to the right hand, and you have to slide early. If you don't slide to the Gates, they're strong enough and good enough to get the shot off, and they're such excellent shooters. There's another goal by Hiller.
Hiller is taking over for Brine in this whole game. Hiller comes in with another shot, beating Lincecum. Another little bit of a screen to help him out. He's really picking his shots well, Donnie. Kind of a similar move. Comes in with his right, goes to his left.
Well, Hiller, one of the reasons he's such an effective shooter is because he shoots the ball when the goalie's not expecting it. And on both of those last two goals, he did just that, and Lincecum wasn't ready.
Well, Hiller has absolutely taken over this game with 7:55 left. Three straight goals by Hiller gives Brine the early lead. And this is Randy Fraser coming in, fast break. And they'll elect to set it up and settle down their offense, get their offensive people on board.
Well, now Brine has Gunning in the game playing defense, and he is their faceoff specialist. Let's see if they take advantage of this matchup.
You've got Tom Carmian, number 23, with the ball.
This is a matchup that Brine should take advantage of.
Gunning trying to play good position defense. Carmine looks for the feed, and he gets it inside. That'll be a goal. Number six pops it through. Roddy Marino from Virginia. Well done. He really exercised a lot of patience then. He didn't force the offense. He just waited for his motion.
Yeah, exactly. You want to try to take advantage of the short stick, especially when it's a specialist like Greg Gunning. And he didn't beat him for a goal, but he drew the defense. And Pietramala, when he's inside, will slide, and they were patient, and they got Pietramala to slide the easy layup.
Matt Wilson tried to back up on that slide, couldn't get there fast enough. So they
his team, with two or three days notice, could beat any team in the world. So I think this Brine team's going to be ready to play.
This is the coach, Dennis Lawler.
So bring it in, Brian. Let's go.
He's got his team in there, couldn't quite hear what he was saying, but he looks very comfortable. He's got his team in there. His team's under control. Mount Washington, very much the favorite, and of course, sometimes that's a burden on you. You come in, you've got the weight of being supposedly better than most. You've got to carry that weight and step it up a notch.
No doubt about it. Mount Washington, people feel they shouldn't lose a game. On that shot, Curry got the shot off, but Curry is a right-hander.
And it was a nice save, of course, by goalie Chris McCabe. Other end of the field, we're getting some good saves early on from Lincecum.
Right, good one-on-one save. Marino, fake low, shot low. You want to fake high, shoot low when you're one-on-one with the goalkeeper. Excellent save, though, by Lincecum.
So the 5:12 left, Brine remains ahead, 4-2. Mount Washington now controlling the ball, working the perimeter.
Here comes that little cutting game they have.
Back right!
The thing that Brine cannot allow the Mount Washington attacking to do is exchange the ball behind the goal. If they are intending to feed the ball, again, they have to get in their gloves and not allow them to have their hands free for the easy feed.
And Don, that time Marl came in, went one-on-one. He held the ball so long, he had four defensemen on him by the time he took that shot. If he makes one or two passes, it's an easy goal. He held it, looked like a little bit too long.
Yeah, Brian's doing a nice job of sliding early. And again, against Mount Washington, that's what you have to do. Slide early, make them pass the ball. Here's Marl.
Watch the attention he attracts.
Actually, not a bad move. He had to kind of re-grip the stick and get a shot off. But again, they split early.
Four defensemen on him. That shot didn't even reach the goalie. 4:14 left. Lincecum with a lot of bodies in front of him as that ball bounces out. Now Mount Washington will try to get Matt Wilson starting the fast break. Wilson with a long stick up to Lou Delegati.
There was an opportunity for Brine to score on an extra man play. They kind of rushed it. And Lincecum made the easy save, and now Mount Washington has the ball again. This is where they're dangerous. Gary Gait is dangerous anywhere, at any time on the field.
Every time the ball goes across midfield, there'll be a lot of substitutions coming from the box at midfield. They substitute on the fly, much like hockey. That time, Paul Gait came in, took it on the fly, got a shot off. Now that midfield unit is balanced up. Right there, Rob Scheck, All-American from Towson State. Great on the run.
Here's the matchup they want, and actually did a great job there defensively, but you're going to see Mount Washington look for the right matchup, and the right matchup is their strong midfielders trying to go against the short stick midfielder of the Brine team.
Mount Washington got off to a 2-0 lead on Gait and Morrow scoring individually. Then it was Hiller with three straight goals to take the lead for Brine, followed by Donovan. 4-2 they lead, and they are in control of the tempo of this game.
Now here, on the other hand, Brine has the ball, and both Gates are in playing defense. So Brine can be patient, look for the good matchup, and
rocket shot by Soudan. We talk about Soudan at the head of the show. This guy is feared in the club ranks. He's got that tremendously fast shot from out front. They gave him the step down, and he takes it.
Well, you know, it's interesting. Brine is going after the long sticks also. They are being very, very aggressive offensively, and I like to see this. They're not holding anything back. Here's another look at it. Fakes right, pulls left, comes in. Look at the screen by number 14. And Lincecum really didn't see the ball. Doing an excellent job screening the outside shots.
David Donovan, number 14, was in front of that one. Duck at the last moment. Now face off. Brian's been controlling knees. And again, Randy Fraser comes in, gets initial control of the ball, loses it now. Good contact by the Wolfpack as they step up the competition by hitting some bodies. But Brine picks up the ball. Misses that pass.
Flag down. Slashing penalty against Mount Washington.
So timeout called by Mount Washington as they try to get a goal out of this man-up opportunity. And here's a hit for you.
Yeah, lacrosse is an aggressive sport. It's a collision sport. And here you'll see that Volker step up and take the man, which gives Hiller the opportunity to go for the ball. Heads up play by Hiller. He's having a heck of a first quarter.
I see Volker hit the man right there. You can hit any player within 5 yards of the ball. If you're in 5 yards of the ball, you can have body contact. And a good play by Volker to clear out that player. Looking at Skip Lickus and Dennis Way as they get these guys trying to get them on track. They scored the first two goals of the game, but five straight for Brine has them in control. And I tell you, they look very comfortable, Don. And as you know, you get that three-goal lead early when you're an underdog, and things are pretty easy for you.
Well, you know, Brine has now settled in. You know, they're the visiting team. They're from the north. And I'm sure they had a lot of questions coming into this game about just how good this Mount Washington squad was. They're playing fearless lacrosse, and it's paying off for them. Mount Washington needs to settle in a little bit themselves, just be a little bit more patient, and I'm sure that Coach Lickus had some choice comments for his team on that timeout.
Don Zimmerman currently coaching the Maryland Rebels, and they lost to Mount Washington last week. Don, they had a big lead against you early. You came back and lost by one goal and had a shot in the closing second.
Right. They had us 8-3 at the half. Early in the third quarter, made it 9-3. But, you know, give our guys credit. We came back and played them tough and actually had a chance to tie it several times and scored with a little after the final whistle.
You can see the wet surface behind the AstroTurf. The field's holding up well, but there has been a constant rain, a constant drizzle since the beginning of this game. Gary Gait now with control.
Now this is where Gary Gait is dangerous. He will go coast to coast. Good check there by
Glenn Stevens coming behind him, but we've seen the Gates take numerous shots. Gary scored in the first one, but maybe the three shots that I remember since then, two by Paul, one by Gary. Brian is constantly getting sticks on their shots.
Right, and that's because they're sliding.
Penalty called right now. It looks like there'll be an extra man opportunity for the Mount Washington squad. They hustle off and get their situation players in there. The red team, no, it looks like it's against Mount Washington. They'll have to clear the ball. There's the penalty right there on Brine. At least that first one was a splash on them. Right into the head. One, two. It'll be five players for Brine. So, yeah, Mount Washington will have the power play. They're talking it over, the refs are right now, so maybe they're not sure. We think it is a power play, according to that replay, for the Mount Washington Wolfpack. 55 seconds left in the 20-minute running time first quarter. Real quiet since the 12-11 mark for Mount Washington. They scored 8 minutes into this game, their second goal of the game. And since then, they've been silent.
Well, this will be a good opportunity for Mount Washington to get a goal here. They're man up. They're a very potent man up team. And they need a goal here. I think this would kind of get them back into the flow a little bit. By the way, Brine is 0-for-2 extra man. And, you know, I think that one of the keys to this game will be man-up opportunities and who can score.
So Mount Washington will get a chance to make this one click. They've got 55 seconds on the clock in this quarter. It'll be a minute penalty. Gary Gates steps out to get it, the natural left-hander.
Actually, both teams are playing a man down. There must have been a step-in penalty by Mount Washington following the first flag called against Brine.
And Gary Gait goes down. You can see the surface getting a little bit slick, but there's that tough left-handed shot. You give him a little bit of space, he gets off and running. Very tough to stop this shot.
Yeah, a little pick action by Paul Gait. Frees Gary's left hand up. You can't let Gary Gait get that left hand. He's big and strong. He's a goal scorer, and he just does a tremendous job of freeing his arms up for an easy goal.
So Gary Gait gets his second goal with 33 seconds left. Not a very sophisticated play, and as you picked up, it was a 5-on-5 situation. So both players, or both teams, with men in the penalty box.
Well, 5-on-5 really is an advantage to the offensive team because there's less congestion. And this is really what Mount Washington thrives on, this type of play.
This is Pietramala with the defensive stick, and he goes wide to the left. The best defender in the country.
No, he'll shoot the ball and is very effective at doing it.
2 seconds left. They don't have much time. Looks like you're not going to get a shot off. That'll be the end of the first quarter. But very interesting. Mount Washington off to a two-goal lead, but then five straight goals by Brine put them in control. Gary Gait scores a third for Mount Washington to give them some hope. But Brine making it very tough as they lead 5-3. Rainy Homewood Field, Brine with a 5-3 lead as we enter into quarter number two. Lee Felsmo and Don Zimmerman bringing you the action. The best of club lacrosse in the United States. The Hall of Fame Lacrosse Classic is the event. The USCLA Club Championship is the game. And this is, look at faceoff, 2-1 in favor of Brine. They also are leading in another very important category, Donnie.
That's right. Ground balls are always the key to the game. And right now, Brine has a 13-7 edge in ground balls. And I attribute that to coming out strong, taking it right to Mount Washington. Mount Washington a little sluggish in that first period. Let's see what they do this second period.
Charlie Blanchard working in the red for Brine against Pietramala, the best in the business. He hooks them from the back. Can't get the ball. And now they work it right in front. What a great save. Tremendous shot.
There's an example. When you're inside with a goalkeeper, you want to fake high to get the goalie stick up in the air and then shoot down at his feet. Goldstein, wide open inside, has the opportunity, shoots high to high. Goalie snuffing.
Curry cleared it for Mount Washington. He is being defensed by Soudan, but now the ball is behind. And Paul Gait, inverting back to the midfield position, takes it against Byrne, now up top. As they start with Bob Martino, he works around with his midfield mates. That's Marino. So Butch Marino and Martino with Todd Curry now controlling the ball. Curry will be defensed by Timmy Soudan. If Curry and Soudan... Soudan just rode him off with the cylinder away from the crease, making the shot pretty much not effective.
Right now, Mount Washington is playing tall gate on the attack, and they will do this to give them a left-hander, a good strong left-hander at the attack position.
Joe Bresci did a nice job of fouling behind the player there and checking as Morrow was getting ready to shoot. Another opportunity lost for Mount Washington. Morrow again with the ball. Back to Blacksmith. Cutter, and the shot goes high and wide. That shot by Butch Marino.
Blacksmith, an excellent feeder. Mount Washington's going to cut all day when he has the ball.
Blatchley played his college ball at Towson State, not too far from this field. Todd Curry picks up the loose ball, feeds behind the back, tries to get a shot for Butch Marino. Now it's picked up, loose ball controlled by the Brine squad. Way up front, they're going to run it. Glenn Stevens trying to pick it up. He's got the long stick. Look how they keep pushing the tempo. Now a moving player, Donovan, down, and he drops the ball. A lot of long sticks. Getting the ball on the carpet.
Well, there's an example of being able to run from your defensive end to your offensive again and against this Mount Washington team. I think Brine can take advantage of that, but they have to make sure that they make the smart decisions on the passes.
Big shot. And Donovan comes in, number 14. Player got his credentials at Duke.
Go, Randy!
Donovan, an impact player, gets the second goal of the game.
Well, Brine is moving the ball and finding the open man. They're not holding on to it. Even if they don't have a transition type opportunity, they continue to move the ball, and they're finding the men open inside against this Mount Washington team.
They get six of the last seven goals, and again, we look at this as they move the ball inside.
That's tough for any goal to save.
So Donovan gets the second goal. The sixth goal for Brine, back to a three-goal lead with 17:30 left in quarter number two. Pietramala controls the loose ball. Now he'll try to ignite some offense for the Wolfpack.
Smart play by Pietramala. Didn't have anything on the transition. Settled it down. And needs help now.
Todd Francis ragging him. And now Pietramala gets back just in time for Todd Curry to go over. He's tired. Pietramala asking for a substitution. It'll be Curry who'll set up the offense. And look how far out now Brine is playing. This is Todd Francis. Is that a sign of confidence for the team?
Well, Todd Curry, one of his strengths is speed, and you don't want a player of his ability to get a running start on him. So you want to try to get in on Todd Curry early and not let him build up that speed that he'll use to try to beat you.
Marino gets his first goal of the game, and that'll be goal number four for Mount Washington from Blatchley.
Just a good heads-up play by Blatchley. Marino, excellent off-ball player. Got open inside, feed was right on the money, and it's an easy goal.
Butch Marino, one of the most feared outside shooters, changes up on the defense by coming in with a nice cut, gets the feed from Blatchley. Score now 6-4 with 16:40 left in quarter number two. Greg Gunning, the faceoff specialist, we're seeing him come off the field, and now they'll balance that unit with Jim Huelskamp coming on.
Mount Washington does play a short stick on their defensive unit. And I guess they have a lot of confidence in Huelskamp being able to stop the other team's number three midfielder.
That shot swallowed up by Dave Linthicum. And his outlet pass gives it to Rob Schick. Rob Schick very tough with open field. All the way over to Blatchley. They were teammates at Towson State. Blatchley somehow gets away from two players. And that ball just picked out of the air. Chris McCabe just snuffed the feed.
Nice one-on-one save by McCabe.
And look at the ground balls. You talked about that a moment ago, Donnie. That really shows you why ball possession has been in Brine's favor.
Right. The team that wins the ground ball war normally wins the ball game.
Hiller working against Klausner. They got a flag, so a delayed call. They'll get a chance for Mr. Mann. Did I see a flag, or was I mistaken? No flag. It must be. Ball goes back to the Mount Washington Wolfpack. Well, I thought I saw a flag. I didn't. So Klausner plays good defense. Ball thrown into Gary Gates.
Okay, here's where Gates dangerous. Little move and go to the goal.
So strong, along with speed. Underhanded right-hand shot. The Gates hardly ever shoot with the right hand. They usually shoot behind the back. They keep it in the left hand, or they cross over. That time he goes to his right and just underhanded.
Well, the reason the Gates normally shoot left-handed is because people can't stop them. But here, they were forced to the right hand, and a nice underhand shovel pass or shovel shot didn't find the net, though.
That shot by Paul Gait hit the defensive player in the back, Jeff McCormick. McCormick, 33, still wincing from the velocity of that one hitting in the back. This is Rob Scheck. Works himself in. Good save by McCabe, and that shot by Morrow goes wide.
Now, Mount Washington that time had the short sticks of the Brine team on the field, and great opportunity.
Scheck takes the shot. Great save by McCabe. We'll be back with second quarter action, 6-4, Brine. Homewood Field, as we get ready to continue quarter number two, Brine, the surprise leader, 6-4. Mount Washington coming in with all the credentials. And this team is very strong from the North, Brine is, and they're showing why they should be considered seriously a contender for this championship. Hiller with three straight goals. Donovan Soudan gave him five straight. Donovan gave him goal number six at 6-4 right now.
Here's a ride that Mount Washington likes to use. It's a midi-on-midi ride, and they'll allow the long stick to come over the field, and they'll be mismatched against the long stick of Mount Washington. Very effective.
They break free, though. Brine gets it clear. Roddy Marino comes in one-on-one. Now it's two-on-one. They get the Hiller. What a big save by Rinsicum. Rinsicum takes a shot from Hiller right in the stick.
Well, not so effective that time. They had the matchup that they wanted. Mount Washington did, but they allowed the attacking to get the ball.
Hiller didn't take the bite on the fake. Stayed right at his ground.
If you look at that replay, Hiller had a one-on-one opportunity. The goalkeeper was extended. Look at his legs. Wide apart. You want to bounce it right in between the legs, what we call a tweener, and pretty much that's a 100% shot right there.
So Linthicum with a big save from Mount Washington. The defense of Linthicum turning back Brine. That could have put him up by three. Now they'll start the Mount Washington Wolfpack controlled offense. The Gait brothers get their line on board. Paul Gait, number nine, Gary Gait, number 22.
And now Brine is caught with two short sticks on the field. Couldn't take advantage of it. Good over-the-head check that time by Byrne.
Well, Byrne is just taking charge in there, stripping him of the ball. There's Paul Gait with a rocket shot. And he beats Chris McKay. They got Paul Gait open on that left side. It's almost all over as soon as it's in his stick.
Well, one thing that we did against Mount Washington last week is we told our defensemen not to venture away from the Gait brothers on loose balls. And that time, the Brine defender did look for the ball, allowed Paul Gait just to get a few steps away from his man, and that's a golden opportunity for them the way they shoot the ball.
Paul Gait, they were tremendous brothers that came out of the Syracuse system, All-Americans. Don Zimmer talked about them revolutionizing the game. They really did change a lot of the offensive techniques used by players all the way down to the youth ranks. Klausner has been facing off ever since early on when faceoff specialist Gunning was 0-for-3. They put Klausner in there, and he's done pretty well.
You know, you speak of the Gates revolutionizing the game. I can remember in 1988 at the championship in Syracuse University, Gary Gates' air Gate shot, which pretty much made history in this sport.
And Gait took a shot right there. It was wide and high with the first shot. That one was followed up right there by number four from Mount Washington, Timmy Horms from Washington College. Now, again, Gary comes in. He's very strong. He beats one player. Now two. He's being double-teamed. He still doesn't give it up and still has possession. Finally checked out. Paul Gait takes the rocket shot, saved by McCabe.
Brine looks a little unsettled right now. They have to get themselves together, check up. And again, this tempo is now turning into Mount Washington's up and down pace that they want. Brine needs to control the tempo.
Barry Kane saved it, got it over to goalie Chris McCabe. He almost lost it, but he gives a little nine iron shot. Scoots the ball the full length of the field, and even though it'll be Mount Washington's ball, it'll be a full 90 yards away from the goal.
That might be your nine iron, Lee.
Well, two. How about a two iron? That's probably the way I hit a nine iron, to tell you the truth. This will be Mike Morrow. Mike Morrow played for you, didn't he, Donnie? And
yeah, he
tremendous
did.
Ball control attackman.
Four-year starter at Hopkins. Member of the all-time Hopkins team, the highest award a Hopkins player can garnish.
Right away put back in because they followed up that shot with good ball control play. Lou Delegati inbounded it, now goes all the way back down to Linthicum.
Again, this is the pace that Mount Washington wants. Up and down, kind of helter-skelter, and Brine needs to collect themselves, get the game at their pace, and not allow Mount Washington to feel comfortable playing this type of lacrosse.
You think the real danger in this kind of pace is that it gives the Gait space?
Oh, it gives the Gait space. It also makes them, allows them to play transition style lacrosse, which is their forte.
Picked out of the air by Chris McCabe, and with 10:37 left, the score 6-5. Brine in red with the lead. Now Washington still controls. Two times now, Brine has failed to clear the ball.
Right, these are second chances, and second chances will kill you in lacrosse. That time, the goalkeeper made a nice save and tried to force an outlet pass up to a long stick.
And high and hard. Absolutely. Bob Martino puts all of his 5-7 frame into that shot. And he rockets one in right underneath the top pipe.
Little circle dodge, we call this. Drives left, circles back for his right hand. Excellent shot.
That'll tie the game at 6. On the strength of Martino's goal, the second quarter will continue in just a moment. Out here now enjoying the fact that it's not raining at Homewood Field. Brine and Mount Washington fighting to a 6-6 tie in quarter number two. The Hall of Fame Classic is the event, a three-day event here at Homewood Field, the USCLA Club Championship. This is the best club players. We talked about a lot of these players will be trying out for the world team in just a couple weeks. About 22 players from these squads will be out there trying out for the best honor this sport can provide. Lee Felsenlaw, Don Zimmerman. And Don, you really think the tempo has been driving the driving force of this game so far?
Right. In the first quarter, Brine controlled the tempo. It was pretty much a half-field game, and that's the tempo they need to establish in order to stop Mount Washington's transition game. In the last 10 minutes or so, it's been a hectic pace, which really feeds on Mount Washington's strengths. And Brine, again, if they want to stay in this ball game, they need to settle the ball down and keep the ball out of the hands of the Mount Washington offensive players.
Butch Marino gets goal number two for him, and four straight now for Mount Washington. Marino really is showing a cannon from the left or right.
Right, here's a left-handed shot. It all starts with the face-off, and Mount Washington has done a better job on the face-offs in the last 10 minutes, and possessions are key.
That shot goes right into the top pipe. Again, four straight. They have the lead. They had the lead 2-0 and then lost it on five straight goals by Brine. Have just gotten that lead back on that Marino goal. And right there, Ryan Klausner facing off with a long stick has been the difference in possession for the Mount Washington Wolfpack. He has been dominant since he came in there.
Sure has. He's done a nice job. And now he's giving Mount Washington the momentum back.
9:34 left, quarter number two. It's running time, 20-minute quarters. International rules for these club teams that are looking forward, a lot of these players, to playing in the World Championships in Manchester, England next year. Marino just scored that goal. He now controls from behind, inverting, trying to take advantage of Tim Soudan's short stick defense. He gets it. Didn't look like much, Don Zimmerman, but that ball went in.
Well, it sure did, and Marino's in a roll right now. He wants the ball. He knows that he can score. That time, he inverted behind the goal on Soudan. And Soudan made the mistake of trailing his stick. If you'll watch, he comes around, he's playing, and now his stick's trailing Marino's stick, which allows Marino to get the shot off. In that situation, you want to get your stick up and your body up and make the offensive player roll.
He got Soudan to bite on that little high fake for a feed and got him off his feet a little bit and then just got the step on him as he came around. Butch Marino, three goals today. He has three of the last, five goals for the Mount Washington team. So he has been a key factor in that comeback. Dennis Way, right in the middle of that pack, the assistant coach for the Wolfpack. Guys look like they've cleared up a beautiful night. 8-6 is the score. And, of course, he's not the only coach there. Bruce Mangles played at Virginia. He's also on the coaching staff. He coaches the defense.
You know, it's good to see Peter Cohn down there. Peter Cohn has been involved with lacrosse for many, many years at both the college and club level. He's a manager. He's taking care of both teams. And just great to see him out here this weekend down in Baltimore.
That was Dennis Way right there. Look at the score by quarters. Brine off to that quick start. Mount Washington, the first two goals, but then Brine five straight. Look at quarter number two.
Don Zimmerman talked about the tempo change, and that's what got the Mount Washington Wolfpack that five-goal little surge. Now they're back in front, 8-6.
And we still have 9 minutes plus to play in the second quarter.
This is going to be a high-scoring affair if the first half has is any indication. Ball out of bounds. They're looking for the call, and
should be a reface.
A reface. Nobody really had a good angle on possession. I guess there was
right, when the ball
advantage.
When the ball scoots out like that, and no one really has an opportunity to play it, then they'll go back and reface the ball.
Randy Fraser, number 13, played at Springfield College. His dad was one of the greatest in the business. Ron Fraser played at Syracuse, is in the Hall of Fame in Long Island. Ron Fraser, his dad, is in the Hall of Fame here in Baltimore. Clauser, number 44, facing off again in white with a long stick. He's been a big, big motivator for the offense of Mount Washington. Here he goes again. Holding on, taking a shot. Not a great shot, Don.
Now here's Brine coming back. They have a little bit of an opportunity. And this is what you have to cash in on against this Mount Washington team. Good stick there.
Two players missed that. But Klausner commanding the faceoff came down. Maybe it would have been better to pass off, you know, getting
Klausner did a nice job on winning the faceoff, but didn't make a real good decision. He tried to get a little cute, fake the pass to the point man, and
this is where they lost it after Klausner, the ball came up to the other end. This is what gave the ball back to Brine. Oh, I'm sorry, back to the Mount Washington.
Yeah, a little push there.
Hard shot by Rob Scheck, and picked up by Chris McCabe, who played at Vermont. Now he outlet.
Good hustle by Scheck, getting back in the hole.
Scheck, number 19, runs the field beautifully. With Scheck and Gait, Paul Gait, Gary Gait, and Scheck on one midfield. They're all about 6'2", 200. Very, very strong, very, very agile players.
Probably the biggest, strongest, most talented midfield playing lacrosse today.
They could play tight end for most football teams. Very, very much an athletic midfield.
Flag down that time. Mount Washington was offsides. Brine worked the ball around, got a shot, and now there'll be a man up for 30 seconds. Nice inside look. Good off-ball movement. Again, one-on-one with the goalkeeper. He cannot shoot high. I think Brine has had three or four opportunities where if they shoot the ball wisely, they score goals. And that could be a big difference later on in this game.
Donovan again with the ball. He's been very active around the goal. He's number 14. Misses that speed from behind. That was Carmian who missed him. Offsides will be the call, and the ball will go back to the Wolfpack. A blown opportunity. We talked about how ineffective Brine has been on the extra man, and so far that could be the costliest mistake for them. They're not that efficient on their extra man opportunity.
Well, it seems to me that they're standing around a lot. I think they need to get some covers in there, move the ball, and get some shots off. They're not even getting shots off, and that's really something that you have to have. You have to at least get the shots.
You got the six against five advantage, but of course you can't score unless you shoot. The basic axiom of the power play. Now the midfield units change. This is Tim Soudan from Massachusetts. He's one of the feared ones in the midfield. He'll try to go one-on-one against Gary Gates. Hard shot, sidearm, picked up by Linthicum, who has looked very good in the second quarter. And Linthicum starts the fast break for Mount Washington.
This is a 5-on-3.
Back to Paul, or Gary Gates, that is. Good roll inside. He goes to the far pipe and just missed it. That was a goal if he had the mark. He had the outside pipe, just missed it.
Look at this. 7 goals from the Mount Washington midfield and 1 from the attack. So it's easy to see that Mount Washington's strength is their midfield. Their attack's doing a nice job of just getting the ball to the right players.
That's why a guy like Byrne, who we focused on in the pregame, is going to be playing a lot of long sticks midfield today. He wants to shut down that potent midfield attack. So you move your best defenseman to the midfield area. Brine will get another chance here as they move it around. They have not looked that controlled or that efficient on offense since late in the first quarter. Soudan with a hard shot. Well, two players in there to turn that shot back.
That was not a good shot, Lee. That was from 20 yards with no screen, and Linthicum just sucked that up. You know, I think Brine has lost a little bit of their patience that they showed early in the game, and need to get that back if they're to stay in this ball game.
Rob Scheck goes against the defense of Stevens, moves it back to Paul Gate, who took his eye off it for a moment. Look at the shot differential. Mount Washington 31-18, almost a 2-1 advantage. This is Paul Gait looking for help. Triple team. He goes through the triple team. He's wide open. Takes a hard shot and goes wide. Unbelievable. Not many guys can go through three players, but they've got the size to do it. The score remains 8-6. The Mount Washington Wolfpack controlling the game after getting behind to Brine. And they're ahead because of the play of the Gait brothers, just like this. We'll be back. Full night, nice and clear now. The field is still just a slight bit damp as we look at Dennis Lawler on the sideline of Brine Lacrosse Club. They're in red. They are now behind 8-6 with 4 minutes left in the second quarter. Leif Elsmo, Don Zimmerman bringing you this action of the USCLA Club Championship.
Here comes that little out-of-bounds play that Mount Washington likes to run. Double cutters. Good job that time of stopping it by the Brine team.
And Joe Bresci gets it back to his goalie, Chris McCabe, who will start the transition. They've had their chances, even though it's been dominated by Mount Washington in control, and they've had more minutes on offense. Don, they've had their moments, but just haven't had good offensive shots.
Well, exactly. And, you know, that whole second quarter up until this point has been Mount Washington playing offense, and that's why they've been able to come back. Brine comes down, on the other hand, takes one shot. It hasn't been very good shooting in the past 10 minutes, and now all of a sudden they're playing defense again. So, again, ball control on the offense is your best defense in this case.
Don Zimmerman has had many great moments on this field. He's a three-time national champion collegiate coach right here at Hopkins, and this AstroTurf, I'm sure, brings back many great memories for him. But he can see and talk in the during the break about the fact that Brine, with the way they play, would be actually pretty good, feeling pretty good, to go in with only a two-goal deficit.
Especially after the second quarter. They have to stop the floodgates. And, you know, if they can do that and go in two goals down, then I think they'll be okay because they'll be able to regroup at the half.
Well, they're going to have a chance to raise this lead a little bit. Brine has had a personal foul. Dennis Way on the sideline calling out the offense. It'll be 6-on-5. It'll be an extra man for the Mount Washington Wolfpack. Not exactly what Brine wants to see. Dennis Lawler on the sideline, but 2:32 left. He'll have to stop another of these offensive explosions from the Mount Washington team. 6-on-5.
A lot of dangerous shooters out there for the Mount Washington team.
Right now, there's only four defensemen out there for Brine. So right now, they're two men down. I don't know if they know it, but they only have four guys out there playing defense.
Well, so two players down, so they're going to have to play a box, and this makes it even tougher. Just try to stay tight, keep your sticks up, make the offense shoot the ball from the outside. This is where you have to play percentages.
Mount Washington moves the ball around well. Not a great shot, though, and picked up beautifully by McCabe, so it didn't take the greatest shot. You really will have a good opportunity if you're patient, 6-on-4. I think the tendency 6-on-4, Don, and you've probably seen a lot of the coaches, that the players tend to hurry it because they feel like they're all going to have a great shot.
Well, that time, the shot selection wasn't bad. It just wasn't executed properly. Mike Morrow came around. No one picked him up, but he shot low to low.
Lou Delagatti just falls down with his shot. Look at this extra man. Nobody is really down at the net yet. Now Delagatti out front. Paul Gait takes one and picked up again by McCabe, who has played sensationally the last few moments. 1:39 left in the second quarter.
Good save that time by McCabe.
This is Byrne, the great long stick defenseman. He gives it upfield to his teammate, Jeff McCormick.
Now, with the no time limit on clearing the ball, I think Brine needs to be patient and take their time clearing the ball and not give up the opportunity. Here's a nice situation here.
Bresci gives it up to Timmy Soudan. Soudan can't see anybody open, so now, finally he does. Trailing player's got it, and they can't get the shot off. Charlie Blanchard came in as a trailing player, was wide open, couldn't pull it down.
Right, they had the 6-on-5, they moved the ball, they found the open man, but he just couldn't handle.
1 minute remaining.
A minute remaining in the second quarter, 8-6. Mount Washington, Wolfpack in white leading. Soudan, the great midfielder, gets whacked in the face. He'll still try to go one-on-one against the defensive Rob Sheck. Pushes it inside, nobody gets the feed through cleanly very often against Pietramala. They like to stick Pietramala into the middle of that defense, and he has a great and accurate stick.
forcing the ball inside a little bit. With 30 seconds to go, I think you have to be patient and work with a real good shot.
Donovan takes it wide, but it's backed up this time by Chris Cameron. Cameron against Klausner. Klausner playing defense. Gets it out front. Shot one more time by Soudan. And he gets knocked down.
There's the timeout called.
And it'll be a timeout now, looks like. Timeout by Mount Washington.
Interesting. I guess Coach Lick just wanted to put his defensive personnel on the field with 16 seconds to go. Not a bad call by Skip.
Well, it's a beautiful night. Clear blue sky here in Baltimore in the beautiful AstroTurf field. 16 seconds left to go, and the ball went out of bounds. It's inbounded very quickly with these international running time rules. So Skip had to call that timeout as quick as he could to get it in, and now he'll make some adjustments to have the best defense you can possibly have with 16 seconds left.
Right, and now Brine will counter with a player of their own. I would imagine that they will try to run some kind of pick inside and feed the ball inside. If it's not open, then they'll put the ball out front and try to get an outside shot screen with 16 seconds to go.
1, 2, 3, ball back. Let's go, guys.
Skip Lickvis.
Let's go, boys.
A guy who has made a tremendous impact to this sport through his career, not only as a player, but as a coach. He gives a lot back to the sport of lacrosse. An All-American player. Played at Towson High School, started his career. A couple years behind me, as a matter of fact.
Then went to Washington Lee and had a great career there.
Tremendous All-American midfielder. And you're looking right now at Dave Linthicum, who has had really a very strong, especially second quarter. He really came into it. There was a run there in the first quarter where he had 5 goals against him, but he settled down and has been very tough to beat.
Here's a little pick play.
Carmine against Pietramala. Not an easy pass for Carmine. No help. And Pietramala just knocks it down. 5 seconds left. They won't get a shot unless they hurry.
It could be dangerous right here.
2-1. Just deflected wide. That would have counted had it been on and in the goal. But it goes wide. The score remains 8-6. Mount Washington, after being down 6-3, scores 5 straight goals. We look at Toby Boucher on the Brine squad, a little bit tired. You can see it's a hot, humid day here in Baltimore, Maryland. The score is 8-6. Our halftime is in front of you. Stay with us. We'll continue with our coverage of the USCLA Club Championship from Homewood Field. Crowd eagerly awaiting the second half of competition for the club championship here at Homewood Field. It's an 8-6 ball game, and let's take a look at how that first half got to be 8-6. To start with Gary Gait early on.
Yeah, here's Gary Gait coming off a little pick by his brother Paul, gets his left hand free. No way to stop that. Easy goal for Gary Gait.
Actually, this made it 5-3. Gary Gait had a goal earlier to make it 2-0, and that was 5-3. Now we go to Marino for his hat trick goal.
This is Marino inverting behind the goal, came around, drew the check from the Brine defender, freed up his right hand for a goal inside.
Now let's take a look at the stats and see where the advantage lies. Face-offs are about even. Shots, they start to go Mount Washington's way.
Yeah, that second quarter was all Mount Washington. The stats show it. 37-21 on shots, shooting percentage. Give Brine the edge on that. But the extra man there is, look, both teams 0-for-4. I would imagine that both teams would pick that up in the second half. Ground balls go to Brine by 5, but Mount Washington came back big in the second period.
And the scoring summary went like this. In the first quarter, was Mount Washington on top 2-0 early on, but then it was 5 straight goals by Brine. The quarter ended 5-3 in Brine's favor. The second quarter, as Don said, was all Mount Washington. A 5-1 run, 3 by Marino, 1 by Paul Gait and Martino, and the score ended up 8-6. We're getting ready for the second half. It's all on the line for the U.S. Championship. Come back to Homewood Field. Score is 8-6. There you see the score, 8-6. We're back at Homewood Field. And a new goalie for the Brine lacrosse team.
Yeah, this is Charlie Toomey. He played lacrosse at Loyola College. And right now he's up in the New England area coaching lacrosse at Knapp. So let's see how he does in the second half. Good goalkeeper.
On the other end of the field, the goalie remains the same. That'll be David Linthicum from Towson, number 13. He's in the nets right there for the Mount Washington team. Again, tempo very key, according to Don Zimmerman in the first half. Let's see if Brine can somehow control the racehorse techniques of the Mount Washington squad. Now moving in, David Donovan, who took a lot of shots early on. He likes to go to the hoop. Works it out to Hiller. Hiller had three straight goals in quarter number one, really to put Brian ahead for the first time. He's going one-on-one now with Brian Volker. A little bit of a clear out for him. Looking for a slide, finally gets it, but misses the connection. And the ball's up top with Tim Soudan. Finally gets it inside. There was a shot that went wide. Charlie Blanchard coming off a pick. Looks like they may be sending a few more picks and trying to start some confusion in the crease area, Don.
Yeah, a little patience that time, although they did force the ball inside, but that's their game. They have to stick with their game plan and see how it matches up against this New Washington defense.
Hiller, Volker again, and Hiller wheels to his left hand.
Here's a matchup I like right now. Dennis Goldstein being played by Haswell Franklin. Goldstein, a very good one-on-one dodger.
Goldstein positions himself, goes to the far pipe, and just misses.
Good turnaround shot. And it's very difficult for a goalie to save because he doesn't get a good view of the ball.
Ball up top now, and David Donovan will start the offense against Gary Gait. Gait wraps him up. The sliding defense didn't do any good, and he came in with a shot that just didn't come off the stick properly. And now Gary Gait off to the races. Injury back on the other end of the field. They'll stop play right now. Down the field is Roddy Marino. Marino obviously not very comfortable, and that was off the ball, Don. I didn't see what happened, but it was when that shot missed in tight, he might have taken a hit from one of the Mount Washington players.
Yeah, I didn't see it either, Lake, but again, when that ball's inside, it's no man's land, and Mount Washington probably came through with body, which is legal.
Roddy Marino played at Virginia.
Stand here and step off when the whistle blows.
One of the elite programs in Division I lacrosse.
Now, Donovan, UVA. Now.
Currently under a new head coaching regime.
Yeah, Dom Storja had a real good first year at Virginia, and I expect a lot more to come out of that program in the next couple of years.
So personnel pretty much the same as we start quarter number three in the second half, except the big goalie change, and we haven't seen him tested yet. So now he is up, Roddy Marino, and not walking at all on his right knee. If you look to the left of your screen, there he is, he's already down. He could have caught the cleats, and Don, you have a lot of experience with this AstroTurf.
Yeah,
that's only speculating, but it could have been maybe he caught a cleat.
Yeah, that doesn't look good. There was no contact made at all. I think Roddy just twisted on his knee, and cleats didn't give, and that's a bad sign.
He's not putting any weight, as you can see, on the right knee. So that doesn't help this team from Brine. Roddy Marino, one of their starting attackmen, comes off the field. Leaves Hiller out there. Number five, Dennis Goldstein out there. And number three, or 23, Tom Carmian goes in. And he gets a lot of playing time anyway.
Yeah, you know, there's a lot to be said about this AstroTurf. It's great for practice when the weather conditions are bad or when it's raining like tonight. You know, you can still get your game in. But it does have a history of knee injuries. And it's tough. It's tough when a player to be playing out here and go down with an injury like that.
Well, all of us have seen a lot of NFL, a lot of Major League stadiums go back to natural surfaces. So it's definitely an area that's inviting some conversation. Rob Scheck now comes in. He's looking for a one-on-one. Wheels around, feeds it off to Morrow. Morrow looking to the crease, gives it to Delegati. And Delegati finds the backside. A well-placed shot against the new goalie, and Charlie Toomey does not get his first save.
No, and that's a tough one to ask a goalkeeper to save coming in off the bench. That time, Scheck drove left-handed. Brine slid. Morrow was able to find Delegati inside. You know, against Scheck, he is much better as a right-hander than a left-hander. And I think that Brine wants to be a little slow sliding to Scheck's left hand. Let him take that shot. That time, everybody came, and the inside was wide open.
Klausner still facing off as we see the score now, 9-6. Klausner, number 44, facing off for Mount Washington with a long stick. And they control again. This will be Paul Gait. They've got a lot of space cleared out for him and his tremendous left hand. Switches over to the right, gets it checked immediately. Francis gave the check, and now they're moving the ball around. This is Stevens, who gets out of the way of Morrow. Now he's coming up looking to transition. He sees defensive men ahead of him, but he didn't see Byrne was charging at the middle of the field, but offsides is the call. It goes back to the Wolfpack.
This is just what Mount Washington wants. Second opportunity, unsettled type situation.
Rings off the pipe, shot by Gary Gate. Now Paul has control, but checked out of his stick. Donnie, it looks innocent every time they lose the ball once, but it does tend to accumulate, and you keep giving chances back to that great offense.
Sure does. And again, here's another example of possession with Brine, and great hit, but they don't like the slash afterwards. Good hit there, now they don't like the slash, and I agree with that.
Dave Pietramala, watch, the hit is legal, he's got the ball, but then that stick check had no purpose because the ball was already out of the stick. They'll move it around. Brine will. They haven't gotten an extra man goal, and they don't get one here either.
Good save that time by Lymphicum.
Volker now controlled. Brian Volker bringing it up the sideline, looking for help. He's got Haswell Franklin in the middle of the field. He can't get it to him. Now finds Blatchley. He can't pick it up cleanly. And a wrap check by Donovan doesn't find the ball. Now Blatchley, a great control player, will just settle things down.
Right, and unlike college lacrosse, where if you get it in the box, the penalty is wiped out, in club, it's the full serve time.
Now Mount Washington White, Todd Curry, the midfielder, gives it back to Blatchley. Blatchley looking through the crease. I don't know how anxious they are to get anything going yet. They are undermanned right now, so I think they'll wait for a very obvious opportunity, if any. Blatchley looking for help. Lost it after Curry. Still playing the man down, Mount Washington is, and they throw the ball away.
Well, that time there was a little confusion on the Mount Washington sideline. The penalty had expired, and they didn't get that sixth man in the game. And break this time for Brine.
Donovan comes down, looks to the wing. Now they feed behind to the point. This is Goldstein looking for help. Over to Hiller. Hiller continues to look to the crease. He'll go against Klausner. It's a great matchup. Hiller, three goals early in the first quarter. Klausner has bottled him up since then.
Brine continues to force that ball inside. And that's a hit or miss play. If you get it, it's a good shot. If you don't, it's coming the other way.
Dave Pietramala comes down, looks for help. Gets it inside. There's Marino, who gets checked over the head. A beautiful check over the head by Joe Bresci. Marino was open for a split second.
There's a break here. They can push it.
Goldstein wheeling back, looking behind, finds nobody open. Finally gives it off to nobody. He'll control it himself. Does not give it to Carmine. This is Goldstein again against Wingate Pritchett. And the ball finally checked out.
Boy, Goldstein one time had an excellent opportunity. Another flag. It's getting rough out there, Lee.
Brine really looked like they were holding the ball a lot. Now, Don, is that because nobody's cutting off the ball?
Well, that time, Goldstein had a matchup that he liked. He wanted to go on Wingate Pritchett, and the midfielder didn't clear through for him, which made it a very difficult barrage.
Here's the unnecessary roughness call. Wingate Pritchett's 15 following the play. There's the unnecessary roughness. Now let's take a look at Marino eluding it. He gets the ball wide open, but look at this check by Bresci right over his head, and Marino was in no position to really set himself to elude that check, so he loses the ball before that last hit that we saw. That hit will put a Mount Washington player in the box and give Brine yet another extra man opportunity. And Don, if they're going to have a chance in this game, I think they've got to connect on one of these.
Well, you know, if a team is going to play physical and you don't make them pay the price by scoring their man up opportunities, they're going to continue to play physical. And I think that it's very important for Brine during this timeout to set up a good play, make sure that they're going to get a high-quality shot and get a goal here.
And see if we can pick up what they're doing, Dennis Lawler's doing in the huddle for Brine.
I would imagine he's setting up a play now, and everybody needs to be on the same page.
Ball goes here, Trojans here. You got it.
An effective man-up team not only has talent, but they play well as a unit. And this is a great opportunity for the Brine team to be together.
You there? And then you got Troche here. Or you got Hills coming down, and you got
So Lawler gets through his group discussion about what they'll do to try to get an effective extra man play. They only have six goals. They haven't scored since about 3 minutes, 2.5 minutes actually, into quarter number two. So it's been a long time since Brine has really gotten a ball and a good test on Linthicum. You think about Linthicum, though, he's had a tremendous second quarter. He turned away some nice shots. And sometimes, Don, I guess that has a tendency to make your shooters think a little bit more than they should.
Yeah, it does, but I think Brine kind of got away from their game plan. They're forcing the ball, and, you know, in any sport, you try to get one goal back at a time. If you get down, you can't try to get it all back at once, because if you do, you're not going to be patient. You know, you're just going to make matters worse.
Now, you notice any different rotation? They started in a 1-3-2.
Well, it looks like they're playing
a little bit of movement out front. They're still
2-3-1. They're in a 2-3-1, and they're trying to draw the slide across the goal and look backside for 21. There it was.
They had a shot. Ball was behind by Charlie Blanchard, and they pick it back up. Carmine now looking out front. He's got somebody. Hiller, the big shot with the left hand, and that one finds the net. We've seen that before. Hiller had three goals, the first three goals for Brine. He really got the offense untracked early on, and so he's a welcome sight for the offense of Brine.
Well, I think Lipscomb's a little upset at himself because I believe that he feels he should have had this shot. Really, no screen, stick side low. He saw it all the way, but just couldn't get his stick on it. Big goal for Brine.
Hiller, the leading scorer in the game. Four goals for him. Watch this left hand. Haswell Franklin comes out, doesn't get much of it. And that ball just trickles in behind Linthicum, who has played wonderfully.
You know, these goalkeepers are probably used to playing on grass. And on a natural field, that ball is going to come up a little bit. On a turf, it's not. And you'll see a lot of those low shots get underneath the goalkeeper's sticks.
Linthicum had a great run. He turned back everything since early on in quarter number two. So he went about a full period without any scores from the Brine team. Flag being thrown in from the sideline, the chief bench official. A procedure call?
Yeah, legal procedure on Whitey, legal substitution. And,
all of a sudden, Brine's going for the
Brine. They have a man advantage here.
Oh, big shot and a big, bigger save by Linthicum.
Linthicum came up big on that play.
Richard now over to the sideline. This will be Volker. They're really trying to spread the riding team from Brine. Volker's got good wheels. Oh, inside and checked down by Soudan. No call made.
Clean check. That was a clean check.
And now they're running gun down the other end. Donovan. Goldstein. Inside, and that shot turned away. Charlie Blanchard takes a point-blank shot. Linthicum turns it away. The score remains 9-7. Brine not capitalizing on some excellent opportunities. 9-7, the score remains in the third quarter. We're back at Homewood Field. The score in the third quarter has grown to 9-8. Brine had an extra man opportunity, and while we were away, they sunk it. That's a good sign for them, and they have crawled back to within one. They did it in pretty good fashion. They've had some opportunities, them, and they're taking advantage of them finally.
Yeah, nice extra pass. That time, Goldstein looks inside and finds Donovan on a real nice extra man goal. You know, right now, Mount Washington is playing very, very physical, and tempers are flaring. I think they need to gain some control of themselves. They don't need to play that way to win this ball game, and the referees aren't letting it go.
So now they're within one, 9-8. It only takes a few little breaks to change that kind of mindset. Brine has been out of it for a little bit. Now they're showing a little bit more confidence if they can take advantage of opportunities. 11 minutes to go in the third, plenty of time.
Brine is still up.
Full serve penalties, and now it'll be again a 6-on-4. Pietramala got a little bit of piece of that, a little piece of that, but it stays with Goldstein and gets it in close to Blanchard, and the shot right in front of Linthicum. What a big save he has made. Several of them right in his face.
Oh, that's a big play right there.
And now they have the extra man on one end. Because of that swing, it'll give them an even up situation, or maybe at least it'll put one more player in the box for Brine, I should say.
Right, that'll kill that man up opportunity for Brine. You know, that was two men up, and you really want to
right
really
want to
throw on that. Yep. Try to ride the goalkeeper, slash the helmet.
Great change of direction by Linthicum may have helped that happen, because he was very quick to change his direction and got his head down low and took the slash.
Well, one thing you teach players is you don't try to check the head of the stick, because if you miss it, it's up in the helmet area and you're going to draw a foul. You always try to check the arms, and that will eliminate the chances of foul in that helmet.
Gary Gait comes in with the left hand, makes one face dodge, and gets the goal. That'll be goal number 10 with 9:47 left on the clock in the third period. Gary Gait, and look at Skip Lickfitt. He is very, very intense on the sideline, but Gary Gait did this one on his own.
Yeah, this is all Gary Gait. Face dodge, gets inside, and sticks it in the near corner. Pretty tough save.
And Skip Lickfitt likes that. He's starting to get intense on the sideline. He wants his team to step up. I think his team has shown that they've had emotional lulls. They kind of get up on a ride, an emotional high for a while, and then they sort of lose that kind of groove that they're
right
in.
I don't care how good a team is. If you don't play with emotion, you're not going to be effective. And Mount Washington seemed to get into a little lull there, and maybe this action back and forth has gotten them back. That's a nice dish right there.
Well, it was 10-8, now it'll be 10-9, and Brian has really taken advantage. They didn't take advantage of a lot of opportunities for a long drought, second quarter into the third, but now they're starting to pay off some of these offensive opportunities.
We'll give Joe Brushy credit here. Here, he came down and made the right decision. He drew the defense, dished off to the attackman, let him score the goal, and that's his job. He did his job. It's no wonder Joe Brushy is an assistant coach at Brown University, and he's practicing what he preaches.
Donovan gets his goal. He's been a force in the shooting end, and gets the second goal of the night, or third goal of the night.
That's just a real good, fundamentally sound play by Brushy.
But now Brine again controlling the faceoff, and there has been a little bit of an emotional change in this game. Looks like the Brine team stepping up a notch, and they're doing it enough to tie the game at 10.
Well, one of the things that's giving Lincoln problems in this game is the shot off the turn, and that time Boucher drove right, came back left, and shot on the turn. And again, the defenders for the Mount Washington team, I think, were distracting Lincoln, but he's got to have that shot. That stick side high.
So the game now tied at 10. Toby Boucher from Ohio Wesleyan, those Midwest programs putting out some excellent talent. Toby Boucher, one of the stars of the Major Indoor Lacrosse League, along with Tim Soudan and Tom Carmian. A lot of these Brine team players, big in the MILL. And Gary Gait gets the ball checked out from behind. That was Toby Boucher making the check. So after scoring the goal, he stays on the field. Mount Washington now will control. 8:31 left. Leif Elsmo, Don Zimmerman in the third quarter of the club championship, the USCLA. And what a big save there. Toomey now starting to feel a little more comfortable.
Yeah, that was a big save for Charlie. He needed one, and he got a big one there.
First shot of the second quarter found its mark, and that didn't have Charlie feeling very comfortable. He gets a couple in the stick. Now he's settling in. Goldstein out front. Hiller behind the back, and Hiller
shot.
He's taking over. Scott Hiller from Massachusetts is well on his way to being an MVP if they can pull this one out. He's got 5 goals, and we're not even halfway through this third quarter.
What a great shot. Catches it on the run, knows he doesn't have a good shot right-handed, throws it over his back, and beats Limpicum. No way he could stop that shot.
So Brian is now finds himself back in the lead, 11-10. They were down as much as 10-6, Zim, and they've gone on a run here to get the lead back.
Well, and look at the face-off stats. Brian's starting to win those face-offs. And, you know, this game could come down to who wins the face-offs.
Well, the big change there was Klausner. Gunning started the game. He wasn't effective, so Klausner was very effective from then on. Now it looks like he could be tiring. We'll see if Skip Lickfitt makes a change and puts Gunning back in. Meanwhile, Mount Washington controls the ball on offense. They're down by one. Haven't been behind for a long time. Morrow. Now this team, even though we've seen that they score a lot of goals from the midfield, Zim, do they initiate from the midfield? Or there's a shot by Morrow.
Great play by Morrow.
Comes in from the wing. Slide was late, and he just laid himself out to get the shot.
Well, Morrow showed a lot of guts on that play. He saw a gap, and he went for it. You know, this move is what separates the good players from the great players. The attacking that are willing to take the hit and to get their nose in there, are the great players. Morrow's a great attacker, and he showed it there on that move.
Score tied at 11 with 7:21 left in the third. There he is one more time. He beat Bresci well outside on the wing. When he had that step, he took advantage of it. And then the slow slide from Glenn Stevens gave him the chance to lay himself out, as Zim says, and only the great players go ahead and make that horizontal move. Look at the score by quarters. Mount Washington with a big second quarter. And Brian controlling the first and the third fairly evenly.
And that was important for them. You know, Mount Washington likes to score in spurts, as they showed in the second period. And Brian now is taking some of that away.
So now Mount Washington will set up their offense. Hidden ball trick. Gary Gait, number 22. Rob Sheck is running mate. Can't get open, so now he gives it inside.
This is Brendan Kelly.
Brendan Kelly, another Johns Hopkins grad. Into Paul Gait, tries to get through. Three players can't, but now Morrow makes two fakes and beats Toomey.
Well, that was your look what I found play. Brian did a pretty good job of sliding, but all of a sudden the ball appears in Morrow's stick and he puts it away.
Starts with Paul Gait trying to go through three players. There he beats one, but he can't beat the double team.
Well, actually, Bresci slid across, and it's the midfielder's responsibility to slide down the backside and cover that attack, and the midfielder did not. There goes Bresci. No one comes down to play Marl. Too late. Easy goal.
And Bresci might not have helped himself with that stutter step. He kind of went, he stopped, and then he went, gave time to the midfielder to come in behind him. Face off again with Mount Washington now up 12-11, and this one won by the team from the north, the Brine Lacrosse team. 12-11, third quarter action, about 5:50 left. They play running time, 20-minute quarters, international rules. This is Dennis Goldstein. Off to the wing to Carmine. Carmine's been quiet since the second quarter. Pietramala working defense on Goldstein. Goldstein looking for help.
They're not going to take Pietramala.
Pietramala now sliding off on the ball a lot. He's mixing up some of the defensive assignments and pretty much trying to get him on the ball. Soudan good over the head check by Volker. Pietramala out front. They try to get inside. They do with the ball checked away at the last moment. Soudan can't find it. He's run over by his own player, and that was Bob Trotchy.
Good hustle by both teams on that play.
Trotchy played at Notre Dame. He'll bring the ball inbound.
Mount Washington has their defensive unit on the field, and it's pretty tough to score against this unit. They're going to go against a short stick.
And this is Rob Sheck, and we talked about his size in. It makes it tough, even though it's a short stick. He's got good speed and great size and strength.
Notice how Volker slid early on that play. When you see that slide coming, you have to move the ball. You can't try to dodge two men. Move the ball to the open man, and you should get a good opportunity.
Brian working the side. Goldstein can't get the shot off. The slide was very effective. It got there in plenty of time. It was Clodston coming across and just checking the ball out of the stick. It'll be on the ground, and the ball will go over. A timeout actually is called, but the possession will be for Mount Washington as we continue in quarter number three. 4:17 left. The Mount Washington team is now in control, 12-11. We'll be back.
The future of sports television is about to dramatically change. A Rebel
LA Club Championship, Brine and Mount Washington, they've swapped leads three times. And right now it's 12-11 in favor of Mount Washington. They started this game 2-0. Brine had a lead twice, and now Mount Washington climbing back in front.
Good isolation move that time by Fraser, trying to take advantage of the short stick.
Lee Felsman along with Don Zimmerman, three-time national champion coach, who coached right here at Johns Hopkins on this field. Don, you were one of the more intense coaches, so you get sort of those intense emotions when you see a championship play, whether you're coaching or not.
Oh, yeah, it's great to watch this game, and I mean, that's the way the game has to be played.
Randy Fraser pops one from the outside. The great midfielder from Springfield. He'll go back to face off the next one, but Number 13 got this one. Watching way out front. They dish it out in front. Donovan gives it to Fraser. And look at this. Around Pietramala. Screens a little bit for Lincecum. Actually, he didn't even go around them. He just used him as a screen. Hit him with a nice hard shot.
That's a good shooter's ploy. Wait until the last minute to shoot the ball. Let the defender come to you. And then shoot the ball through the defender. And he acts as a screen to the goalkeeper. And it's obvious that Lincecum is having trouble seeing the ball when it's screened.
Now Brian again controlling the faceoff. That has been part of the ball control story here. Early on, it was Mount Washington getting a lot of faceoffs and consequently a lot of shots. In the second half, Brian has really worked on that element of their game. They've gotten a lot of faceoffs for them and consequently a lot of possessions, and they're starting to take advantage of it. Hiller,
good patience here.
He's got five goals. He's going to command some attention. The matchup is against Cloudston. Is that one that you think would favor?
Well, I think it's a good matchup, but I think they're going to go against the short stick. Hiller's not a dodger. He's more of a finisher. He'll position himself off the ball. Good save that time.
Toby Boucher gets the short stick. Marino, he didn't get the goal, and now Marino's off to the races. One man to beat. He gives it to Blatchley. Blatchley trying to dodge since everybody was covered. And he's picked up nicely by Barry Kane.
Great job by Fraser that time, Leaf, getting into the hole and taking away the break.
You see ground balls 33-28, fairly even. And again, that's been a roller coaster ride. It hasn't been sort of matches the swing of the game.
No, I'd have to give this quarter so far to Brian. You know, they were outplayed by Mount Washington in the second period and come out back nicely in the third period. Tied the game.
5-3. And they get the ball back again. Now Mount Washington
got a break.
Taking clean shots.
They've got a break. They still have it. They still have it. Brushy's got it now.
Brushy with a big stick makes a fake. Shoots wide to his left.
They're going to call that a pass. They're going to call it a pass, and it was.
So Brushy faked a shot, tried to go to the wing, and loses control. Now Brushy has to go back very tired, but they'll get the ball back because of the errant pass.
Well, Brian did a nice job of pushing the break that time. You know, I think both teams are a little tired. Club lacrosse is a little different than college. The players are pretty much on their own to get in condition. And in a game of this intensity and this heat, you know, right now these players are feeling it.
Tim Soudan going one-on-one and gets inside of the defense and wide of the net. This is probably one of the better conditioning years for these team players, though, because of the team tryouts of the USA. Each of the guys that are candidates are in the best shape they can possibly be in. Shot comes in. They're going to call it no goal because he was in the crease. What looked like a goal is wiped out because he was in the crease. Tom Sarmean on the sideline. But Hiller almost got number six.
Scotty Frederick was right there. Let's see if the call's right.
Tough to say because it has to be he has to be in the crease before the ball goes behind the net. Here's Hiller with what would have been his sixth goal. He is a force on the offensive side for the Brine team. He ends up in there. Did he end up in there before the goal broke the plane? Yes, according to the referees. No goal is the call. The score remains 12-12 as we end quarter number three. We're back at Homewood Field in Baltimore, Maryland. Leif Elsmo, Don Zimmerman in the fourth quarter of the USCLA Club Championship for lacrosse. This is the granddaddy. If you're out of the collegiate ranks, this is the best competition you can get.
Well, now you're going to see these world-class players really turning on. They got 20 minutes, nothing to hold back, and this is for all the marbles. So, should be a great fourth quarter.
Ron Clauser is still facing off for Mount Washington. He's been there since about 5 minutes or 10 minutes into the first quarter. Gunning, the faceoff specialist, was ineffective. Clauser went in there and has done a very good job, although in the third quarter he was not as dominant. And we'll have to see if they stick with that technique because he has to play the full field and that wears a guy down.
Well, what it does is even if he doesn't win the ball, Lee, he's in there playing defense. And that's premium right now in this game.
Don, how much do you think it takes out of him? I'm in the school that says it takes definitely a certain amount out of a player just to face off. So how much less of a defenseman, is he, because he's spending some energy facing off?
Well, it's going to take its toll on him, definitely, but, you know, I think it's a good ploy by Skip Lickfus.
Ball now controlled by Brine, 12-12, all coming down to the last 20-minute running time quarter for this championship. There's a bounce shot by Brine. Linthicum now looking a little bit shaky, and Brine again goes up 13-12.
Well, you know, should he have had it? I don't know. It didn't look like it was screened, but... No, I think he should have had it. Went right between his legs.
Well, it really looks like he misread it. He was going high on the shot, and it bounced underneath him.
Right. I think he was anticipating the ball going one place and overstepped, and went right the old tweener.
So very quickly, Brine takes the lead. A little over a minute into this final quarter of play, and I tell you, that does a lot for your confidence. When you come in as the underdog, you enter the fourth quarter with a one-goal lead.
Well, let's see what they do now. You know, Mount Washington is not used to being behind, and let's see how they face this. Let's see if they continue to play within themselves, or if they, get overly aggressive and give Brine some golden opportunities.
So if you're,
there's plenty of time left.
If you're coaching Brine, you're saying, look, just wait your chance. Try to frustrate this team. Try to let them make some dumb mistakes.
Right, but you've got to stay within your game plan also on the offensive end. You can't become conservative to the point where you're playing not to lose rather than play to win. Brine has been playing to win this game, and they have to continue to play with that mentality.
Right now they're taking some time off the clock at the very least. Here's Carmian, bounces one. This is the second shot he's taken, and it looked like Pietramala may have saved that one. Here comes Linthicum. This could be a fast break. Off to the wing, and now they've got one with Matt Wilson. Matt Wilson digging down. He's got finally Gary Gait, takes a bounce shot wide.
Well, that was a 5-on-4, and Wilson did a nice job of dishing the ball off to Gait. Gait didn't hit the net.
Blatchley now controls behind the ball, put right back in with these international rules. Running time quarters. We're looking at Gary. He's a little bit tired from that full field run. Gary and Paul Gait will be playing for their team in Canada, the national team, as they go to Manchester, England next year. Gary wearing a box helmet right now. He had many years of successful play up there with his brother in the box leagues of Canada. This is Marl looking for help, and he's getting hit pretty good by Jeff McCormick. Now the big gun. Here's Gary wide open. That'll be tough to stop, and nobody can.
Well, nobody can stop that. Gary Gait, you know, he's a great player. One of the reasons he's a great player is because he plays hard all the time.
Gary Gait gets yet another goal. He has scored in three of the four quarters. He comes in with a famous left hand, ties the score for his team at 13-all. We'll be back with more fourth quarter action. The score is 13-13. We're in the fourth quarter crunch time for these two teams, the best in club lacrosse. Brine from the north, playing the Mount Washington Wolfpack. And they have a storied history here in the southern region. Wolfpack dominated for years, had some down years, but they're on the way back the last five. And here they are with Sheck trying to get a shot off. And the defense finally comes in with John Gower putting in a check. That rocket shot comes from the Gait brothers. That was Paul, and that one finds the mark. Another Gait shot that really nobody, once they unleash it, not much you can say about it.
I don't even think the goalies can see it.
Blatchley starts it, gets it up top,
dishes off. You know, that's a great job by Blatchley. He's a feeder, and he knows his role. Gates the scorer, and he's unselfish, gives the ball up to the scorer, and they score a goal. Now Washington came down on a 5-on-3 that time, got a little cute with a behind-the-back pass, but were able to cash in on a later opportunity.
Clauser, 44 and white, stays in there to face off. He's losing this one. I think he's gotten a little weaker, maybe some fatigue factor. We'll see if Skip Lickfus stays with him. He's an important part of the defense, and obviously the heat and humidity may be taking a little bit of a toll on Clauser, but Brine continues to do probably a better job than Mount Washington in the second half of this game for facing off.
Carlson does look a little tired. He's playing inside on the crease. And if anywhere on defense, you can rest there.
Goldstein comes in, tripped up from behind. by Matt Wilson. He got the best of Wilson. Wilson reached in with a stick, tripped him up. It'll be an extra man situation as we look at Goldstein for the Brine squad. And if you ever want to get your offense on court, here's the chance. Goldstein initiates, and he's getting ragged by Klausner. Extra man for Brine. They look up top. Sudan
doing a 3-3.
Well, it looks like a timeout. Somebody doesn't like what they see out there. 14-16 left in the game. The championship on the line. Brine needs a goal, and they scored. Brine team did on a power play. Their extra man is really starting to get effective.
Right, that time Brine went to a 1-4-1, did a little curly Q inside. Number 14, Donovan, got open. Excellent inside player and put it away over Lincoln's left shoulder.
Donovan, a big night for him. Unofficially, 4 goals on my tally sheet. Score all tied at 14. Now Washington now settling things down. Look at this ride put on by Goldstein. He comes from Carolina, and they ride pretty well down there.
This is that matchup ride also. They're going to try to have a long stick, bring it over, and then they're going to jump him. That time they allowed the midfielder to get the ball, though. Pietramala is not the type of player you want to jump.
Great stick skills.
Stick skills and speed make him as dangerous as any short stick.
Now Marino with a great outside shot. Gets a little juke move to give him some space, but Toomey deflects it wide. Curry back to Paulgate, who starts behind. Boy, this puts a lot of pressure on the defense.
Got to get up on his left.
One on one. He wheels in. 6-2, 2-10 maybe. Very strong, the Gait brothers. And you can see it's tough for one player to match up against them. They really need help.
Well, exactly. And you got to get up on his left hand and force him to go right. That time, Byrne went for the over the head, which allowed Gait to get his left hand. And that's a goal from that position. You're better off forcing him back to roll to his right hand and then slide.
Another one-goal lead for Mount Washington, Paul Gait. 3 goals for him and 3 goals for his brother, Gary. So the Gait brothers, 6 of the 15 goals for that family.
Clausen looks real tired now, Lee, if you called it.
I think he's taking a toll. I wouldn't be surprised to see Skip Lickvist make a move back to Gunning or somebody who's fresh. Now Mount Washington peels back. They've got the one-goal lead in the ball. Pietramala will balance back up. Good look at Bob Martino. That excellent Washington College program. A lot of great players coming out of the Eastern Shore program here in Maryland. Marino has had a hot hand lately. Getting some big shots in there. There's another shot and a goal. Marino looking real comfortable and challenging the Brine defense.
Well, that time the defender playing Marino just gave him too much room. And, Butch Marino is too good of a shooter to allow him to shoot uncontested at 10 yards.
Watch this. As he gets a little step, he'll make the juke move. Tough to know which side he's going to go to. And he gets that little stutter step. Great velocity on a shot. Look at that. Brings a stick head low, shoots high. I've seen Don Zimmerman out here coaching some of his players out here with that very shot. Dropping the stick low, shooting high. It's tough for the goalie to track it because he goes down with the stick head and then it opens up a nice white target above his shoulder.
Yeah, it's a nice move. And, again, not used to playing in these lights. It's tough on the goalkeepers, and I think you're seeing it.
Two-goal lead for Mount Washington. Leads of that size have been rare in the last 20 minutes. Gary Gait looking for space. Dishes it off to the far side. Ball checked out.
They got a break. Brine has a 5-on-4 here. Let's see if they can cash in.
Branch is looking for help off to the wing, and they bring it down to Hiller, who's been the big offensive scorer. Warding off is going to be the call. You saw Hiller's offhand pushing away the defensive check.
Yep, and Rich Tamburino was right there and made the call. That's an opportunity that Brine has to cash in on. It looks like Mount Washington's a little tired getting back on defense, and the 5-on-4s are excellent opportunities from which to score goals.
Oh, Again, the gambling defense of the Brine team puts them in a little bit of a disadvantage in close, but finally they pick it up. Toomey has it now, looking for the outlet. He finds Jeff McCormick. McCormick now trying to outrun Marino.
Got a trailer here, number 11.
This is Boucher from Carmian. A rocket shot from the left, and Boucher is well off the mark. At 6x6 is the target, so he missed that by about 2 feet.
He's lucky he did, because there was no screen on it, and Linthicum would have made that save.
Ball now moved up into the offensive end of the field for Mount Washington. 9:37 left. Two-goal lead for this team. The Wolfpack in white. Leif Elsmo, Don Zimmerman. This is the USCLA, the United States Club Lacrosse Association, the granddaddy of lacrosse clubs in the United States. And we're seeing a lot of world team players out here tonight. They'll be playing in Manchester, England next year. Gary Gait now comes on. They've worked that midfield, a fresh unit on.
Well, Mount Washington does an interesting thing in their substitutions. They substitute what we call midline, which allows them to keep those short sticks of Brine on the field. And it paid off here, because now the Brine's forced to play with their short sticks.
And meanwhile, Brendan Kelly, an All-American from John Hopkins right here playing for Don Zimmerman, gets a big goal, a 17th goal for his team, and a 3-goal lead. Kelly, tremendous job from the midfield. 3-goal lead will carry into the last 9 minutes. We'll be back with more fourth quarter action in just a moment.
I wish my son could live a full, healthy life where he felt rewarded and was always learning.
Encyclopedia Britannica presents a parent's wish list.
Washington is extra. Penalty on Randy Fraser, and as we get under 8 minutes, they're 6-5 with a 3-goal lead. A bad spot as Charlie Toomey suffocates that ball. And this is really a turning point, I would say, Don. If they're going to have a chance, they really need to turn this offensive opportunity away.
Well, that was a big save by Toomey. Down by three, if Mount Washington were able to score on that extra man opportunity, it would have been tough. But big save by Charlie.
And that keeps
him in it.
Yeah, they'll have to eat up some time here. Get back to full strength. Midfield again from Mount Washington, very overpowering. 13 of the 17 goals coming from the midfield.
Well, when you have the Gates, Rob Sheck, and Butch Marino out there,
and then a lot of guys next to him like Brendan Kelly and the like, which are great support players. Very tough to stop them, and that's been the secret of this Mount Washington success. 17-14, they lead in the fourth quarter. Leif Elsmo, Don Zimmerman. We're under 7 minutes in this USCLA championship for 1993. Hiller, 5 goals tonight for Hiller. He's looking for number 6 against
Rob Sheck. Short stick on him. It's a matchup they like. Let's see if he doesn't try to take advantage.
Well, that's the exact call they made on the other end, so at least they're consistent. They're going to call that call, and Mike, the referee, made the same call on both ends, and that's good officiating.
Yes, very good officiating.
And now Brine will have the extra man. They've got to get some shots in close, and the backup, two guys in there. Clausen backed up Goldie Linthicum, and the shot did not find the net. Out of bounds, and Mount Washington gets possession. Boy, Brine really hurried their opportunity.
Well, they did, and not only did they hurry it, but there was a ground ball that could have easily been gotten, and just didn't concentrate on it the way he had to, and now Mount Washington has the ball again.
Brine putting a little bit of a pressure on this ride. Linthicum, when the ball's on the ground, if they can get Linthicum to drop it, the net is wide open. Nobody in the goal. Linthicum is out trying to assist in the clear. Look at Volker with the wheel.
That's Gary. Offside on the white team.
They're good inside. Let's see if they pick it up.
White team's offside.
Shot in close. Toomey makes a big save. Nobody's picked up the offside. Sheck comes on from the box. Well, if it was offside, they got away with it. Here comes Brine. A lot of wheels inside. There's a hard shot and a goal. Beautiful shot by Charlie Blanchard. And that transition was just like Mount Washington loved it. But this time it was the Brine team. If you look at Randy Fraser on the sideline.
Well, if you look at Gary Gait coming off the field, he's got his helmet off. He's looking at the scoreboard. You know, they ask a lot of Gary, and like I said before, he goes all out. And right now I think he's tired. So Brine again needs to take advantage of their transition from defense to offense, which they did that time.
That collision wrist off of the right of the shot, but a beautiful shot it was by Charlie Blanchard. Goal 15.
Flag down.
Now Washington controls. They've got the benefit of a shot. And Toomey now looking very comfortable in the goal. Deflects another one. Don Zimmerman, this game's been tied 7 times. It was tied at 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. And then the 17-14 lead by Mount Washington. And now Brine trying to close it back. We'll be back with the closing moments. We've got 4:35 left in the game. A 2-goal lead for Mount. Charlie Blanchard brought his team back to within 2. Gary Gait took over. At this point, it was 17-15. It was an extra man play. Gary Gait just cranks it up from up top. That was goal 18. And the 3-goal lead is exactly where we stand. With 1 minute left in the contest, a comfortable 3-goal lead for the Mount Washington Wolfpack.
That may have been the clincher lead.
Brine trying to get one last one here. Hiller with his 6th goal try. Doesn't get it. A big save from Lincoln. I don't know if it would have made a difference in the outcome, but that was a heck of a save by Lincoln. He stood right in the face of that shot by Hiller.
Well, I think it would have made a difference. You know, 2 goals in 50 seconds has certainly been done before, but it's going to be tough.
There's a rocket shot from outside. Blanchard. The last 2 goals scored by this man, Charlie Blanchard, from Ohio Wesleyan. 44 seconds. Blanchard looking good from the midfield.
Nice little left-handed move. Takes the check. Shoots a high, hard one. Lincoln probably didn't see it. Ball has some velocity on it.
34 goals scored. A very high-scoring game. It wasn't that long ago that the club championship played on this field. It was a 7-5 affair. So they've worked out some kinks in how to get around the big long stick defenders.
That's a big face-off by Clausen.
Clausen showing his ability to use that 72-inch defensive stick. He's still very agile with it. Now they'll move the ball around. They've got 4 players in that end of the field against 3 players riding for Brine. 27 seconds left. This one is all but over. And Mount Washington Wolfpack will be the USCLA champion for 1993. 15 seconds left. Now, Don talking to eternal optimist of the coaching. A coach
well,
who never says die.
I mean, it's 18-16, and they're coming down a little unsettled.
9 seconds and counting. They'll just hold it. Dave Pietramala in the corner. Now it's 7-6. He's throwing it all the way down. Let's see if it bounces out. 3-2-1, and that'll do it. Mount Washington wins a big game. They had to fight back. This game was tied 5 times in the second half. At 10, 11, 12, 13, and 14, they finally win 18-16. And it's 4 Gait goals of the last 6. So the Gaits took over in the fourth quarter. We'll be back with our... in just a moment.
A high cholesterol level is bad for you. On the other hand, there's good cholesterol. Does that remark confuse you too? Because there are many contradictory statements on health thrown at you every day, you need the Wellness Letter, the University of California, Berkeley newsletter on nutrition, fitness, and stress management. Delivered once a month, the Wellness